What do you associate with the autumn season? Is it the falling leaves, the warm drinks, Halloween, candy apples, maybe even something else entirely? It's by far the coziest season, I think, and its aesthetics are absolutely worth relishing in. That's why last month I asked my Discord to think of what they associate with the fall and turn it into some original Pokemon or a regional form. I got over 24 entries, and seeing the process of you guys making awesome designs to celebrate the season has been a great start to my fall. Now it's finally time to give back, where I'll show off each submission that I managed to give a redesign for. I'm proud to say that I was able to get to a vast majority of submissions. For those I missed, don't worry, because I'll be sure to do another one of these seasonal art challenges again soon enough. But now, sit back, and let's celebrate the autumn season through Pokemon. A video like this is truly a reflection of how much we all love the fall, and want to be immersed in every element of it. So there's nothing better to shout out than the current box brought to us by Sakura Co., the sponsors of today's video. That's right, Sakura Co. and Tokyo Treat are pairs of Japanese snack subscription boxes that each offer delicious treats that you won't be able to find here in the US. While Tokyo Treat tends to boast more modern flair, Sakura Co. goes down the traditional route, as you can see from this month's awesome box that they were kind enough to send me. This month, to get fully immersed in the fall spirit, Sakura Co. has partnered with the Ibaraki Prefecture to give us Ibaraki Harvest, a neat collection that reflects the region's rich agricultural heritage, with tons of crunchy and fruity options perfect for fall snacking. I really enjoyed this white peach cookie from the Okayama Prefecture. I've literally never had a fruit-flavored cookie before, so this was a very welcome surprise in terms of taste. I also really got a kick out of this bag of konbu, which is a type of edible kelp. Super salty, super flavorful. I gotta say, as much as I love Delmize and Dragalge, eating this kelp was one of the highlights of the box, and now I'm craving some more. All snacks also pair excellently with the Ibaraki Sencha tea in this month's box, which I found super tasty, as I'm a pretty big tea guy. What's more, each Sakura Co. box comes with a piece of tableware, which is a fantastic addition to any kitchen setting, and a fun thing to collect. So if any of the Sakura Co. offerings sound good to you, and you're looking to support the channel, please make sure to check out the link below to get one of your own. And if you use my code TAMVALLEY, you'll also get $5 off of a box of your choice, either Sakura Co. or Tokyo Treat. I see no better way to get into the fall spirit than this. So once again, thanks to Sakura Co. and Tokyo Treat for sponsoring the channel and making big videos like this possible. First up, I see no better Pokemon to highlight than one literally made out of the primary thing that autumn is associated with, leaves. So here's Autumnal Sandygast from Charge. The sand is replaced with a pile of fallen leaves, and the sand shovel is now a miniature rake. As this is the first and perhaps the most straightforward redesign, well, it was a pretty easy redesign. Here's my version. No real differences, besides the inclusion of a few more stray leaves here and there, just to add some charm without overdoing it. I can't express enough how neat our first design is today. So clever how fallen dead leaves work into the body of a ghost type. Autumnal Sandygast roam around forest floors, hiding in shadowy overgrowth. They sneak up on young woodland Pokemon in the black of night before swallowing them whole. They use their rake to sense vibrations in the ground, and they can ensnare a Pokemon in just an instant. If you ever hear the rustle of leaves behind you in the forest, run. They are notoriously hard to escape from due to their ability to flatten down and hide, or elongate the hundreds of leaves that comprise their body. Next, the potato gives us this awesome hedgehog friend, Heliohog. Heliohog is apparently based on hedgehogs, obviously, alongside sunflowers, which are a very underrated autumn plant. It's not an association that I would have made on my own, so I'm super psyched to be able to translate it here. The potato also made sure to note that Heliohog draws tertiary inspiration from the country of Macedonia. Their Independence Day is September 8th, a nice early fall festivity, and their flag really does look like the bursting pattern of a sunflower, so it's a really perfect tie-in. For my redesign, my foremost goal was to just get Heliohog closer to the Sugimori style, so I adjusted proportions here and there, and definitely not a Pokemon that I would have made on my own, so I'm really happy with how it turned out. I also got rid of those orange quills and opted to make the flowers themselves the quills to streamline the design. I really wanted to honor Macedonia with that burst pattern as well, hence why the red and the yellow leaves overlap, but they alternate. Oh yeah, and I added sunflower seed whiskers, which I thought was pretty cute. Heliohog are born looking like the flowers and foliage in which they hide, although having the necessary defenses and stamina to take on other Pokemon in fights, they prefer peace, and tend to avoid conflict whenever they can. Their vibrant foliage allows them to easily camouflage in giant piles of leaves and go almost unseen to the naked eye, as the spikes that cover its back are bright and colorful, yet sharp. Their density can be controlled by Heliohog to deliver nasty stings to unsuspecting predators. From above, these Pokemon look like a sun, and one faraway region regards this Pokemon as a national and a cultural symbol. Next, Sassafrasinate gives us this neat Autumnal Leavanny, based on a pile of autumn leaves and a spooky scarecrow. A very classic autumn design, and definitely one I was expecting someone to submit for this project. So here we go. The colors used here are absolutely gorgeous, a flawless combination of beauty while still evoking something really creepy. I love how it looks so fragile yet so dangerous, so I stayed pretty close to the source material with my version, which keeps the same exact pose. I only made a few small changes, like replacing the giant tendril on its head with something a bit more fitting of the scarecrow concept, so I added super dry and dead leaves or straw throughout its body, almost like it's stuffed like a decrepit scarecrow in a field. I also made sure to accentuate its lower jaw, which I think adds to the spook factor. A very unsettling but very endearing design. It has eaten so many leaves that it's developed a thick coating of them, a mix of fresh and rotting ones that offer extra protection. This abundance of foliage renders it nearly immobile. It stays out of direct sunlight and it camouflages within dense piles of leaves. Careful to stay very still, it waits for its prey to come close before it ensnares them in its gaping maw, or tears them to bits with its razor-sharp scythes. This Pokemon is extremely territorial and perceptive of its surroundings, so experienced farmers like to keep them as pest control. Scientists are studying their convergence with Cacturn, unsure how to classify these strange beings taxonomically. Now things get even weirder with this excellent submission from Nye, Morteel. This seems to be a moray eel leaping out of a pile of autumn leaves, incorporating both elements of a trash bag full of leaves and even a zombie, I think, from the bolt in the head. A really unique concept that yet again incorporates those beautiful autumn leaves. So here's my redesign. I essentially kept the same exact pose as the source material, because it just looks so neat jumping out of that leaf pile. However, I tried and tried again to make the body look like a trash bag as I assumed the original was intended to be, but it just didn't look right. So I went for a more stitched fabric look, with classic stuffing innards leaking out of its seams. That way it plays more into the zombie aspect of the design as it's a dark, not a grass type. It also kind of reminds me of Oogie Boogie from Nightmare Before Christmas, another cool nod to Halloween. Solitary creatures, Morteel make their homes in discarded, rotting leaf piles off the beaten path. That way, they can sense the vibrations of nearby small prey and leap up in one big motion, swallowing them whole. They rely on their gaping maw as their only form of attack, as their bodies are incredibly fragile. Physical contact is easily able to rip the seams and reveal its assortment of trinkets that it swallows, which may include trash, leaves, and even discarded human objects. Its true form is unknown, hidden beneath the stuffing, as scientists postulate that it may share similarities to Mimikyu. Attempts to reveal the ghost inside have been fruitless so far. Next up is Bloody359's Horrifly, a neat hybrid of a monarch butterfly, a parasitic vampire, and even some elements of Batesian mimicry, where a relatively fragile animal mimics a more dangerous one to ward off predators, evidenced by the blue spots on Horrifly's wings. This was a super neat concept to play with, and I tried to incorporate all three while especially playing up that last one. So here's my Horrifly, who has a skull-like facial hood, the coloration of a vampire's cloak, and tons of details to reference its role as a decoy predator. You can see that from its usual position, its outstretched wings look like the massive face of a scary predator, with giant eyes and its white thorax acting as decoy teeth in the middle, in a sense. However, flip Horrifly upside down, and the bottom spots on its lower wings and lower thorax now help this Pokemon look like a spider, with that mouth again, but now with eight eyes. It's a double mimic, and I chose to have two possibilities given that this Pokemon is also based off of a vampire and thus bats. So it likely hangs out upside down on trees, and displays that arachnid mimic form more to ward off rodent or small bird Pokemon. Overall, I was very pleased with my ability to show off this Pokemon's main mechanic through its art, but the concept from Bloody 359 was just so good, so thanks for letting me bring it to life. Typically found in temperate forests, Horrifly wandered through the night sky in search of prey. It's said they search for wandering souls to feast on. This diet allows them to intensify the glow of their wings, which very often scares off predators or wandering trainers, especially given its loosely face-like patterns. If on the brink of starvation, however, they will resort to sapping the life force out of a living being. During the day, they typically roost in the shade, motionless and upside down. But once eye contact is made with prey, they will attack with unrelenting fierceness. Despite their fearsome disposition, their bodies are incredibly light, frail, and sensitive to changing conditions. As soon as the leaves change, they migrate down to more tropical regions to avoid the harsh winters of their home. This mass migration has inspired a local holiday that commemorates these Pokemon, and the community's respect for them. Now this last one was super fun. Zach Gonna Slay drew up Phantail, a really neat nautical ghost type inspired by Madame Leota, the disembodied head floating in a crystal ball found in Disney's Haunted Mansion properties. Such a unique inspiration for a Pokemon, and I love the twist on the whole crystal ball thing by having it be octopus legs holding up that water bubble. Is this Pokemon a dead octopus with a dead fish for a brain? Is it a ghost entity disguising as an octopus with the fish just along for the ride? Or is the fish controlling the whole operation? Who knows? I kept it vague in my redesign, which again was just to update it to the Sugimori style and give it a more expressive pose. I decided that it's most likely a mysterious cephalopod creature hiding in a cracked cauldron, which supports a mini fish tank bubble on top of it, where the skeleton of a forgotten Magikarp, Feebas, or maybe even Basculin sits dormant. I imagine the dead fish Pokemon is what gives Phantail its ghostly aura, and the fish can rattle around in the jar, while the octopus does the majority of moving and attacking. A true symbiotic relationship. Mischievous cephalopod Pokemon sometimes wander into the moats of haunted mansions and wiggle their way into any crevice they can find. When they come across cauldrons imbued with a ghostly aura, a Phantail is born. Foes are often discombobulated from the sight of this Pokemon, which boasts not one but two decoy faces. Attacking the fish that acts as the head does no good to harm Phantail. One must fight through its flailing arms to reach the true body. With its newfound locomotion and powers, it loves to wander around the halls of these mansions and frighten visitors. Next up, let's keep the spooky designs going with this Autumnal Meganium variant found from Krebsilicious. This is a very out there design, inspired by the Headless Horseman folktale, sugar maple trees, and jack-o'-lanterns. It's apparently meant to fit into a New England inspired aesthetic, and I think it works great. I really love the idea of a detachable head Pokemon without it being outright graphic or unrealistic for the franchise. So for my redesign, I absolutely kept the Headless Horseman aesthetic first and foremost, with that detachability super emphasized by having the head be permanently floating up above, with will-o'-wisp-like attachments that encircle it. I can envision this Pokemon looking super cool in 3D, and I tried to make the wisps wrap around the head, to also allude to a pilgrim's bonnet, further showcasing that New England fall aesthetic. I also took some creative liberties in terms of color, making the body a purple-brown petrified wood like the trunk of a maple tree, rather than the jack-o'-lantern head. As much as I wanted to, it just didn't fit for the redesign that I was going for. I think I might be proudest of how this one came out over any other in the series. So thanks, Krebsilicious, for providing such an awesome concept. This variant of Meganium is most active in the fall, when ghost-type Pokemon are greatest in number. After eating too many cursed vegetables, it has become imbued with the spirits trapped within, altering its once smooth hide to become petrified, and giving it a more solitary yet aloof personality. It uses its detachable head to hide in rocky nooks and leaf piles, then it jumps out to scare people and Pokemon. Its wispy mane is hot to the touch, but it emits a sweet aroma that punctuates the crisp air of the harvest season. It was once called the Wisp of the Forest by settlers of days past who spotted this elusive beast on the wooded outskirts of villages. Now, what's Halloween without a little bit of cats? Good thing Diluc drew up Spookitty, an adorable sheet ghost Pokemon mixed with a cat and even candy corn. I love the idea of a friendly feline spirit taking on the form of some of the season's most iconic symbols. So for my redesign, the primary goal was just to make the design a bit more cohesive around the idea of candy corn, rather than a sheet made out of leaves. I added some candy corn patterns on its ears, tail, and body, and I made it all stitched together like it's made out of sheets or paper mache, which would support its grass typing. I also made the actual cat creature visible in the tail, as if it's poking out and controlling a much larger sheet body, which I think makes it really creepy in a cartoony way. Really glad that we got some adorable, wholesome entries in here. Spookitty are said to be the souls of cat-like Pokemon who became lost while playing in a pile of autumn leaves. Despite being ghosts, they are extremely friendly and sociable Pokemon. During the autumn season, they drift around near piles of leaves, and they invite other Pokemon to come play with them. When frightened, they can billow their sheet bodies as if they were raising their hairs. They are often spooked by loud noises, and they prefer to lounge in sunlit gaps beneath the autumn canopies. Why don't we keep this cat theme going for a bit longer and introduce Momonga's Scheline, which is based off of yet another Disney character, the Cheshire Cat from Alice in Wonderland. This design is just so neat. I love how abstract it looks while still bearing resemblance to its source material through the stripes and unique tail. I think the color scheme is flawless. So I kept it in my redesign and just redid the pose slightly to show how this Pokemon can elongate and use its patterns to disorient foes when hanging out on tree branches, just like the Cheshire Cat. It almost looks like a weird version of Furret, which I love. Again, I didn't really have to do much to translate this abstract design, which would fit in excellently in Galar's Glimwood Tangle or Kalos's Route 14. This Pokemon lives in the heavy fogs of autumnal forests, particularly around dense groves. Scheline always sports a big glowing grin and glowing eyes that stand out in this murky environment. It may act as a helpful guide to those lost in the fog, but it's also very likely to just play tricks on them. Thanks to its mercurial personality, there is no predicting Scheline's behavior. It can ward off foes with its strange blinding lights, or it can seemingly slink out of any encounter and escape back into the fog. Next, let's stray away from all these woodland Halloween creatures and head to the classroom for the autumn season, where we find Solar's Boomite, an awesome little dragon bug who uses the ripped pages of library books as wings. This design is absolutely genius. I love the fact that it's a literal book worm, a very believable Pokemon design. For my version, I kept virtually the same colors while just making those eyes a bit more bug-like, to balance out the reptilian and insectoid qualities of this Pokemon, almost like the Flygon family does. Next, I added some details to the wings, which are meant to be colored illustrations from a book, which mimics the pterostigma spots on insect wings pretty nicely. Finally, I wanted to really drive home the book motif, so I gave it a longer lizard tongue to look more deliberately like a bookmark. I think being deliberate with visual motifs is very important with even simple Pokemon like this. Colonies of Boomite make libraries their home, seen as pests by many. Weak and largely incapable of flight in this larval stage, they tear out pages of books and attach it to themselves as wings. Each Boomite sports a slightly different appearance because they adopt different pages depending on what they choose to read. Their long tongues are used to rip out pages thanks to their sticky natures and corrosive acids that often burn holes in pages. However, when calm, this saliva can be used as bookbinding glue, so they're kept as companions by patient librarians, especially because these Pokemon are incredibly polite and quiet. Second to last today, we've got Fi's Deimire, a very spooky hybrid between a Noken, a type of Scandinavian swamp troll, and a traditional werewolf. Very fitting for Halloween. I love the contrast between the droopy elements of swamp plants and mud coating the body with sharper, harder elements that the bone facial covering provides. Playing up that contrast was key in my redesign, which just amps up the spook factor, anthropomorphism, color, and contrast, both in terms of the color itself between the mud and the fur elements, as well as how sharp I chose to make the skull pattern, almost like the bones are fragmented as if it were smashed through combat. I also made sure to give it a ridged back like it's a hunched over werewolf that just transformed. That arch provided by a solid mass of plants, which it uses to hide underwater and camouflage when it needs to. I hope I did right by the concept while still providing an admittedly big departure, far more than most of the other submissions in this video. But that's what we're here for. Incredibly dangerous Pokemon, Deimire are known to inhabit swamps. It hides itself underwater, leaving only its still back of moss floating, while waiting for prey, humans and Pokemon alike. A captivating but ethereal melody seems to seep out of its body, attracting bystanders to prey upon. This eerie noise is especially heard on cold autumn nights. When curious travelers peer into the swamp to investigate, they find themselves staring down Deimire's gaping maws. It used to be both venerated and deeply feared. It is said that ancient people wouldn't set foot in swamps without having steel objects to throw into the water to keep it at bay. Finally, I was able to get one last submission with this spooky autumnal Spiritomb that my girlfriend insisted that I bring to life. She provided the rough concept, which is essentially a Spiritomb face carved into a witch's cauldron, with instructions to bring back all of Spiritomb's inner dot and spirit elements as the boiling goo within the cauldron. I like it. So that's exactly what I did, having some fun conveying some motion here with the bubbles rising into the air from the heat, and the purple goo spilling over onto its face. I like that I was able to bring Spiritomb's exact colors back, in a regional variant, without it looking too similar. I can't think of any other regional form that really does such a thing, while looking so different from its source material. 1,000 years ago, a coven of witches found these strange Pokemon in the woods, banished from other regions. As they crafted their brews, Spiritomb fused with the concoction, creating this unusual variant. Contrary to their usual vengeful selves, autumnal Spiritomb are far more jolly and aloof, happy to forage materials to craft new spells for anyone curious enough to tamper with them. This Pokemon seems to have full control of the liquid within, and the cauldron itself. They waddle about on their cauldron's legs, expelling foul-smelling bubbles when happy, and shooting corrosive goo when upset or protective. And just like that, we've run through each and every submission. That I had time to redesign, that is. This project got so much support, and over 30 individual Pokemon were submitted. So as much as I wish that I could have drawn each one of them, I at least want to give a huge shout out to the ones that were submitted that I didn't get to. Leading off, we've got Huskorch from Sinnoh. A really neat burnt husk of a tree, so it looks like the classic depiction of a dead tree outside of a haunted mansion or a graveyard. Really neat stuff, and I love the dual faces. There's a lot of potential for this concept. Then Henry sent in a pair of Hedgemon and Spirufo, two Pokemon that seem to have a symbiotic relationship, with the preppy Hedgemon obsessing over its appearance and keeping only the freshest of leaves on its body, and Spirufo trimming those dead leaves off and making a home for itself as a barber ghost. I love that dynamic, and I especially think Spirufo is super unique and adorable. Next, we've got Siphani from Jock, a pair of classic comedy and tragedy masks which are actually ghost pomegranates, the cheerful one being a summer form, and the dreary one being a winter form when the pomegranate dies. I'm very intrigued by this concept, and may have to return to these in a future video focused on summer or winter Fakemon redesigns. Here's Jackhost and Pumpkabomb, a classic pair of sentient jack-o'-lanterns, and it looks like the second one exploded, exposing the inner goo. I love the concept here, and I think there's a lot of potential for a gooey humanoid Pokemon wearing the shell of a pumpkin, almost like a bomb suit. Lots of potential here. Moonlight Steps sent in this awesome little grass fox known as Lox. Super cute design that would have been cool to give a nice changing leaves coat to, as this drawing alludes to. Next, here's Gobleaf and Trollitter from Churly. A nice evolution line based off of woodland trolls. This pair would have fit excellently in Galar, with the likes of Impidimp and family. I love how expressive both these Pokemon are. Neck Punch sent in Grimleaf. A neat take on a Grim Reaper. A cool detail they added is that its scythe is a tool to sap life energy from Pokemon and people and return it to the forest, a very vengeful and menacing protector. Here's a whole family from Chunchun Maru, who gives us Rapit, Jabuk, and Jackucross, a cool line of jackalopes with a martial arts bent. I love the iteration of this line into something very muscular and almost moose-like, with those antlers on Jackucross. Definitely reminds me of a starter line. And finally, what's an autumn collection without a cornucopia? Here's Autumnivore from the K-Dog, a disembodied head feasting on anything it can find. Super clever to make the ghostly wisp behind it allude to a cornucopia full of food. A very adorable design that I wish I could have taken on. And with that, Well, we've looked at every single submission for this project. I want to lend a sincere thanks to everyone who submitted a Fakemon, both those who I was able to redesign and those who participated nonetheless. I hope this was an accurate representation of all the things that we love about autumn, and what makes the season so special to begin with. Before we end this, why don't we head to the woods for one last autumn celebration? Once again, a sincere thanks to everyone who took part in this challenge. Autumn almost feels like a time of renewal, so it's a great time to acknowledge that it's been a great year for the channel, and I can't wait to see what comes next. If you want to participate in a future one that I might do for winter, spring, or even summer, please make sure to check out the Tam Valley Discord to make future videos like this possible. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time for more content.